Thanks for joining us here on The Open. After a federal election campaign which saw plenty of mudslinging, Prime Minister Justin Trudeau is set to meet with opposition leaders this week to find common ground in the new minority government. He has also agreed to meet with Saskatchewan Premier Scott Moe. Issues such as pipelines and carbon taxes will no doubt surface in those conversations. And a new Nanos research poll finds noticeable support on both subjects. For more on all of this, we're joined by former Foreign Affairs Minister Peter MacKay, a partner at the law firm Baker McKenzie. Peter, thanks as always for joining us.
Pleasure to be here, John.
So we're kind of moving into that post-election period where clearly the Prime Minister is going to be having conversations both with opposition leaders but also with provincial leaders as well. What are you going to be watching for?
Well, not only the subject matters that you mentioned, but also talk coming out of the West and the discussions around Wexit more broadly, which are real. Certainly there was a sentiment there of great frustration, even bleeding into anger about job losses, lack of support for the energy sector. But Jason Kenney has floated the idea of a pension plan for Alberta.
Yeah.
I suspect that Scott Moe may also be looking at this subject matter. So there's a great deal of tension that is brewing. Obviously, it's a great idea for the Prime Minister to be meeting with opposition members because he's going to have his hands full in terms of Parliament itself and how things proceed, how legislative agendas are moving. But those tensions, fissures, if you will, between Western provinces and the centre of the country, very reminiscent of what we saw in Quebec back in the 80s and 90s, something that we know can be very detrimental to the economy and to direct foreign investment, because people look at that, a national unity issue, as somewhat of a real pressure on the economy and on how the economy will perform.
When you talk about that Wexit worry being real, how are you measuring it?
Well, I'm measuring it anecdotally and speaking directly to people in Western Canada who are describing, in the major cities in Calgary, like Calgary, Edmonton, massive real estate vacancies in the downtown, which is one indicator. But the job losses in the energy sector are prolific. That has a ripple effect throughout the economy in Western Canada. So not just Alberta, Saskatchewan, and to a large degree Manitoba. This is putting a lot of pressure on those premiers, and they need to show their ability to flex their muscle and get Ottawa to pay attention. And so while government isn't entirely responsible, obviously the price of oil, obviously there are other pressures, but we are certainly seeing a very real, I hate to deem it this, but a separatist movement on the ground in the Western provinces.
Now, there's a balancing act of sorts, especially for the Liberal government, because even today there's some polling from Nanos Research, which shows on the one hand support for issues like pipelines, and on the other hand, support for the carbon tax. So I wonder what will come out of the conversations, whether it's with opposition leaders or with provincial leaders like Scott Moe, when there is support on both of those issues right now.
It's almost generational, it's regional. There are many ways that you can divide these subject matters up. There's no question that climate change played a major role in the election itself. What you do about it seems to be the issue. Taxes versus some sort of technological investment and change, and what gets us there. And what I've heard from a lot of people, and keeping in mind that even the United Nations speaks of this transition period to upwards of 30 and 40 years, is what pays for that transition, what will get us to a better place in terms of how we deal with greenhouse gas emissions. Taxing pollution, and carbon is not always pollution, there are many different scientific factors in this, but Canada can and should be a leader in the area of green energy, green technology, but paying for it obviously is going to come from the energy sector itself, and that means continuing to produce oil and gas, getting it to the coastlines, getting it to market is the issue that is most prevalent right now.
All right, let's just go back to something you referenced earlier with Jason Kenney. We've talked about it a couple of times on the program today, this idea, I mean, speaking of pensions, this idea of getting a fair deal and now having this consultation period. I guess one of the initial questions is, if you're Alberta and you pull out of the Canada pension plan, I mean, what are the ramifications of that? So what's going to be part of the dialogue over the next couple of months as those issues get debated?
Well, I mean, one of the major factors, John, is that when times are good and people are working and the province is generating enormous revenues, particularly from the oil sector, it made sense. doing it now when the economy is very flat and people are struggling. In fact, people are leaving. A lot of folks from Atlantic Canada and other parts of Canada are going back to their original communities. And so it is a pressure tactic, to be sure. But whether the economics of it add up and whether this is something that Alberta will actually follow through on remains to be seen. I believe it's a bit like them taking a page out of the province of Quebec and seeing how they have leveraged the government of Canada for years. And let's not forget that Albertans rightly feel bitter about sending a lot of transfer payments to the rest of the country in their good times. They didn't retain a lot of those earnings.
Just finally on the subject, with pipelines specifically, where do you see things going, in particular with Trans Mountain, as we move into 2020?
Well, tremendous pressure now that it's owned by taxpayers to actually see a return on that $4.5 billion investment. A lot of political pressure, clearly, from the West. But again, the dynamics are difficult to sort out. You have British Columbia, who seem still quite opposed, at least to the provincial government level. Tensions within activists, Aboriginal communities, but the economic pressure on Alberta and Saskatchewan in particular is something that is going to put them in a head-on collision with the Trudeau government. Now, of course, we have a minority government with all of the opposition parties, with the exception of the Conservatives, lining up on the side of the government, which is to perhaps delay, further confuse the issue, and not move forward. I don't think it looks great, to be honest, and in spite of the musings of the Prime Minister that they're going to move full force ahead, I'm not sure we're going to see shovels in the ground anytime soon when it comes to Trans Mountain. The pipe's there, people are ready to go, certainly the market is there, and yet we're still not seeing much progress to point to.
So there are some divisive issues that we'll continue to watch unfold. Today, hopefully a day that brings everyone together.
Correct.
Or gets us thinking of others. Tell us about the importance of Remembrance Day from your perspective.
Well, I'm headed to a service right now, and it's a reminder not only of past generations, but the current generation of veterans that we have, and the solemn obligation to take care of them, to embrace them, to thank them, to express each and every day, not just Remembrance Day, that we are forever in their debt. And their service is something that allows us to enjoy all the freedoms that we do have in this country. This is a country that is blessed. It's a country that other countries aspire to be like. And those men and women in uniform who have given their all are truly our greatest citizens.
All right. Peter, good to get your perspective. Thanks very much for stopping by this morning.
Thank you, John.
Peter McKay, partner at the law firm Baker McKenzie and former foreign affairs minister, joining us.